वो रहेगा है ना क्वेश्चन कुछ।
या
ओके
सो
सो प्लीज शेयर द स्क्रीन फर्स्ट एंड देन वी स्टार्ट।
Yeah, you seeing this slide?
Yes, I can see this. Yes.
Okay, good. So I can start?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah. Professor Ravi Prakash, thank you very much for inviting me for this talk. So I am happy to give the talk in your university because I am earlier I was in Santiago, Chile with I was working as a postdoctorate fellow at CMM Santiago, Chile with Professor Carlos Conca. So I am happy to connect with Chilean people again. Okay. So in this talk, I am going to talk about the differential equation on time scales. So my lecture will be not very advanced. Half part will be theoretical, very elementary things and fundamental mathematics related with differential equation and time scale. And then in the half part, I am going to give some research problem, going to talk about some research problems. Okay. So our first thing is what is the time scale and why we want to study the time scale. So this is the outline of my talk. So first few slides will be motivation behind the this time scale theory. What is the motivation behind the time scale theory? And then I will give the I will talk about the this time scale theory and what is that. And then I will introduce the concept of the controllability for the differential equation. And then I will in the fourth section I will give. And this, I will state the research problem, and then I will try to use this time scale theory to solve these problems. Okay, and then in the last few slide, you you can see the some important differences related with the time scale theory and controllability of differential equation. So motivation behind the time scale. So we all know that differential equations and difference equations are very very important for the application point of view. So it is important that we should know some theory where this differential equation and difference equation will work together. Okay. So if we want to study the some differential equation and difference equation, then we need the different theory for solving the differential equation and difference equation. So now the motivation behind this time scale theory is that, is it possible that we have only one theory and that will work for the differential equation as well as for the difference equation? So this is the motivation behind the time scale, because time scale is a theory which will work for the differential equation as well as for the difference equation. Okay, so in general, one investigate the discrete and continuous dynamical system separately, and most of the result have to be proved for each case. Means we need to study the discrete analysis and continuous analysis on the different scale. Okay, so we have some physical system, they are not perfectly modeled by the either differential equation or difference equation, but they are need the differential equation and difference equation both together for their modeling. Okay, so for example, this is the some case of some insect Megacicada and this Ferrocicada. This is the some insect you can find in Australia. So there, if you want to model this life cycle of this insect, then what we need? We need the continuous and discrete analysis both. So for example, if for this modeling of this cicada, we need this this set, means this is the domain for the time, okay? So, and this set is not only for this continuous, and not it is also for the only discrete, so it is the combination of both. So the motivation for the time scale is that if we have some model which require the continuous analysis and difference analysis both at the same time, then we need to study this time scale theory. So in order to study the dynamics of such types of model which requires the continuous as well as discrete theory, we use either a difference equation or differential equation, but we cannot accurately describe the law of their development, means we cannot perfectly model that dynamics. Okay, therefore we need a theory that works simultaneously for continuous and discrete analysis. So what is the main importance of this time scale theory is that this time scale theory is the bridge between the discrete and continuous analysis, which generalize and extend the traditional continuous dynamical system and discrete dynamical system into a single unified theory. Single unified theory means this theory will work for the continuous as well as discrete dynamical system both. So time scale is offering a formalism for studying hybrid discrete continuous dynamical system. So this is the, if we are going to apply this discrete theory, this time scale theory on the modeling of some problem, then we can say this is the hybrid system. Hybrid, if we have some hybrid system, then it is the very good to apply the time scale theory, because time scale theory is good for the hybrid system. So any system or dynamical system which need the continuous as well as discrete modeling at the same time, then that kind of system some people also called as the dynamic system. This is not the dynamical system, that is called the dynamic system. So the results obtained on time scale will be true for the discrete time system. Discrete time system means our time domain is the set of integers, the set of positive real numbers, and maybe also that is the set of positive integers and so on. And continuous time system means if you have t is equal to r, as well as for any non-uniform time domain. For example, if we just take our time domain is the q to the power n, where q is greater than n, okay, then that is also, that is called the quantum calculus, okay. So for this kind of domain, we need this time scale theory. So the power of theory lies in the arbitrary choice of time scale, means we can choose maybe some continuous set, we may can choose the discrete set, we may can choose the any arbitrary set which contains the continuous point as well as discrete point. Even this theory is also will work for the counter set, okay? So now I think we are able to motivate that why we need this time scale theory. So what is the time scale? So first question is the, what is the time scale? So a time scale T is an arbitrary non-empty closed subset of real number R. So any closed subset of R is called the time scale, provided, and what is the topology we consider on that set is the induced topology of R, means our usual topology of R we can consider as the induced topology on the time scale T. So in the below you can find that these are the some examples of the time scale set, okay? So R itself is this time scale, and even that set of integers we can know, we know that R is itself open and closed, so it is closed, therefore it can be considered as the time scale. And Z is also is a closed set, closed subset of R, so it also can be considered as the time scale. And the set of natural number, and n 0, n union 0. This is all R closed subset of R, so they can be considered at the time scale. And here Hz, we have the Z 1, 2, 3. So this Hz means this is the multiple of H. So H, 1, 2H, 3H and so on. So H belonging to R is the constant. And this is another notation for the time scale that is called the PAB set. So this PAB set, we know that this PAB set is suitable for the modeling of that cicada type insect, which the modeling of which population dynamics need the continuous as well as discrete time domain. And this is to the power n, is n in Z union 0. So these are the some closed subset of R, and hence they are the time scale. And just like the interval on the set of real number, we have the time scale interval also. So AB, this time scale, T is the set of all T in time scale T, such that T is lie between A and B. And in the same way, we can define the open set in the time scale and semi-open and semi-closed set in the time scale T and so on. So we can see that this time scale is not a continuous set. They are not the continuous set. So they have a lot of jumps. That's why we need some jump operators. That's why we need some operators which will be useful for the studying of this kind of problems on the time scale. So first operator, we need the forward jump operator, and this is denoted by the notation sigma. So sigma is the mapping from the time scale to T to time scale T, such that sigma T is the infimum of all S in T, such that T is less than S, and infimum of phi is equal to supremum of T. And similarly, we need the backward jump operator, which is denoted by the symbol rho. And greediness operator, which is denoted by nu, and nu is the, this is the sigma T minus T, this is the jump, okay? Nu T is the jump between the two consecutive points. So if, for example, we assume that our time scale T is the Hz, then what will be sigma T? Sigma T will be T plus H, and rho T, this for backward jump operator will be T minus H, and this graininess operator will be equal to H. So these we are going to use. Actually, what is the our main motive behind the definition of all these things? Because we want to define a derivative on the time scale, which will be useful for the set of integers and the quantum calculus and the continuous calculus, which will be work for the all this time domain. So just like this forward jump operator, backward jump operators, we also need the some classification of points. One is called the right scattered if T less than sigma T, and left scattered if T greater than rho T. And similarly, we have the right dense if T less than supremum of T, and with T is equal to sigma T, and left dense if T greater than infimum T, and T is equal to rho T. And here also we have the isolated point and the dense point. So dense if sigma T is equal to T is equal to rho T, then this is called the dense point. So here we have the classification of points by the figures. We can check that this T1 is left dense and as well as right dense, and this T2 is the left dense, but it is right scattered. And similarly, T3 is the left scattered, but it is right dense. And then point T4 is the left scattered as well as right scattered, and that you can see that this T1 is dense and T4 is isolated. This T2 and T3, they are not isolated. So here are the some examples of the how we going to find this sigma T rho T if we choose the some particular time scale. So if T is equal to R, set of R means set of real number, so then sigma T is equal to T. and then roti is equal to t also means there are not no jump between the two points in the set of real numbers. That's why they are the sigma t and rho t are the same, and nu t is equal to sigma t minus t. So this is zero. So there is no jump between these two points. Therefore, we have nu t is equal to zero. And now for the, if we just take our time scale is equal to z, then for any t in z, sigma t is the t plus 1 and rho t is t minus 1. So this rho t is work as the backward operator and the sigma t is work as the forward operator. So here we can see that this relation is going to be defined. So now here if we just take this t is equal to n0 square, so in this case we need the sigma n square will be n plus 1 square, and rho n square it will be n minus 1 square, and nu n square will be sigma n square minus n square. So here n plus 1 square and then n square, so it is 2n plus 1. So this is the difference between this between two point in this n0 square time scale. So now here we have this Hilgert derivative. What is the meaning of this? So this derivative is not very old. Actually, this derivative was first introduced by the German scholar Hilger in his thesis in 1988. So people just start working on this Hilger derivative and all these things since 1988. So this is just 20 or 22 years old theory. So if T has a left scattered and maximum M, then we denote Tk is equal to T minus M and Tk is equal to T. Otherwise, Tk is equal to T. So now here we have the, what is the Hilger derivative? So this Hilger derivative also some people call the delta derivatives or Hilger derivative. And here this is the mod F sigma T minus Fs minus F delta T. This F delta T, this is the our Hilger derivative or delta derivative. And what is this sigma T? This sigma T is the our forward jump operator. Okay. This is forward jump operator. So if our t becomes r, then we can see that sigma t is equal to t. Then in this case, our this f sigma delta derivative becomes our normal derivative. If this sigma, if our t is equal to our time scale is equal to set of integers, then sigma t will be t plus 1. Okay, in that case, we have the forward jump operator. Here we can see that, so this is the our Hilger derivative or delta derivatives, and we can see I will give one example where this derivative will be equivalent in all the cases. Okay, it is equivalent for the well defined for the set of real number, for the set of integers, for the set of for the quantum calculus and so on. For all these theorem is this going derivative going to work. Okay, so mod ft sigma t, this is the this f delta t is called the delta or Hilger derivative of f. So let f and g are the delta differentiable at t, then the following holds. Here we can see that in the sum and difference derivative for the function f and g is the same as the our normal derivative. And if we have the sum alpha is the sum constant, then the derivative of alpha f is also work in the same way as our normal derivative or our regular derivative. And now this is the product of two function. Derivative of the product of two function is just little different here. What we have just different thing that g is the function of sigma t instead of gt. Okay, if we have this t becomes our the set of real number, then we will see that fg and derivative t is, will be, this is ft g dash t plus f dash t into gt. Okay, but only difference is here what we have is this this sigma t. And similarly in the this quotient derivative of the quotient function f over g, we have the same thing here, only we have the difference in g of sigma t. So if this is not equal to 0, then this quantity is well defined and then we can define the delta derivative of the quotient function f over g. Here is the example. We have that how this derivative is equivalent to the our normal derivative. For example, we have f t to r. If we just take f t is equal to t square, this is the our function, and we know that f delta t is equal to t plus sigma t. This is the our formula for the derivatives. So if we just take t is equal to r, in this case t is equal to r, then we know that the derivative of t square will be 2t, and we know that if we just take this t is equal to z set of integers, then this derivative, what becomes this derivative? This derivative becomes the forward operators. This derivative will becomes the forward operators. In this case, we know that the forward derivative of this ft is equal to t square will be 2t plus 1. Okay, and if we just take t is equal to hz, this time scale, then we know that this becomes 2t plus h. And if we just take t is equal to 1 over n, n is belonging to n union 0, our time scale becomes this, and then our derivatives will be equal to 2t minus t square upon 1 minus t. And this t is equal to q to the power n, n is in the set of integers, and q greater than 1, union 0. This t is called the quantum calculus, quantum time scale. So in this case, the derivatives will be denoted as q plus 1 time t. And if we have this different union, and we have the disconnected set, and then the derivative will be 2t, and in this case we have the 2t plus 1. So on, this we can verify that this is the, if we have the different time scale, then what will be the delta derivatives or Hilgert derivatives. So even also we need the sum, because we know that in the some cases this log function or exponential function is not defined everywhere. So we need the new notion of the function, that is called the regressive function. And then this function p is called regressive if this quantity is not equal to 0. Why we need this definition? Because if we want to define the exponential function in the case of the time scale theory, so epts is equal to exponential s to t log 1 plus nu t pt. We know that if this quantity will be 0, then this quantity will not be defined. That's why we need the regressive function. So if p is regressive, then we can define the exponential epts is equal to like this thing, and this is well defined because 1 plus nu t is not equal to 0. And when nu t is equal to 0, then we define epts is equal to exp and pt minus 1. This is the our normal exponential function. So if we have this first order this ODE means delta derivative, y delta derivative of t is equal to pty, where p is regressive, and this is the our initial point, initial condition yt0 is equal to 1 on t, then this EPST, this is the solution of our this problem. Now here if we have this finite dimensional system of equations. Okay, so if A is in the CRD, means set of all RD continuous function, and F is also RD continuous function, and X0 is in Rn, then this matrix system is a solution of this matrix system will be given by this equation. This XT is equal to phi A T T naught. This phi A is the transition matrix of our homogeneous equation. I think I just want to mention here one thing, that all the definition of this continuity and all other things is well defined in the set of this continuous in this set time scale set theory. Okay, so this phi a t is the transition matrix of this homogeneous equation corresponding to equation this. Homogeneous equation means x delta derivative of t is equal to a t x t. Okay, so ft is equal to 0, then we call the homogeneous equation. Now we have here a motivation for the controllability. What is the meaning of the controllability? So for example, we have this differential equation dx over dt is equal to minus 2x and x0 is equal to 1. Initial condition is this. And what we want? We want that the solution of this initial value problem satisfy this condition. X at 2.5 is equal to 0.91. So this is the our problem. And we want to find the condition. We want that our solution satisfy this condition x at 2.5 is equal to 0.91. But we know that the solution of this initial value problem will be given by this graph rxt is equal to e to the power minus 2t. And we can see that if we just take x is equal t is equal to 2.5, then what will be the value of this solution will be almost 0. Almost 0. So this target point, what we want to that our solution satisfied is not satisfied. So what we need to do? We need to add some variables in our initial value problem in such a way that our solution satisfied this condition. So in this case, what we did? We add a non-homogeneous. Yes.
Malik sir, your voice is not coming.
Hello.
I can hear.
Now you are able to listen me. Rabi.
It's okay now.
Okay. Thank you. So what is the our target? Our target was that I want to find the value of x at 2.5 is equal to 0.91. But this here we see that this value of the solution at x is equal t is equal to 2.5 is almost 0. So what we did, we just add some non-homogeneous terms and t plus 1 in this our initial value problem. And then we find the solution of this system, and then we will see that the solution of this system is passing through the our target point. We can see that at t is equal to 2.5, it is our solution is satisfying x at 2.5 is equal to 0.91 almost. Okay. So this term sin t plus 1, this is called the control term. And this whole system, we can say that the control system. And this whole process to achieve our target from the initial point is called the controllability. So what is the controllability? The achieving our target from the initial point by choosing some suitable control is called the controllability.
Muslim?
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe it would be nice if you can explain, since maybe there are students, how you try to find this control, the sin t plus 1, what is the choice?
Yeah, that for the finding this control theory, this is just motivation I have given that how this control theory is going to work. Okay, we are just in the coming slides, I will show that how we select this control and answer and so on. And also, if anyone want to do this fundamental theory related with this controllability, so he can find this notes of the professor Raju K. George. He is from the IIST Trivandrum. So his notes is available on the internet. And if also anyone want, I can send that slide also. Okay, so this motivation is that if we want to find our target set, we need to add something, or we need some variable in the system which we can change in such a way that our target is achieved. So achieving the target by choosing some suitable parameter from the initial condition, it is called the controllability. Okay. So there are some different kind of controllability.
Muslim?
Yes.
Sorry to interrupt you again. If you can go one slide back.
Yes.
So instead of adding the sin t plus 1, you could have also played with the coefficient minus 2 and put a a, and maybe it would have also worked, no? Meaning
No... that is also. There are the two kind of controllability. Yes. One is called the distributive controllability, another is called the multiplicative controllability. Okay. So here we are doing the distributive controllability. So in the multiplicative controllability, we have the coefficient of some our this derivative term or our our dependent variable term. If that coefficient we change and we get the our target, then that is called the multiplicative controllability. Okay. But here I am discussing about the distributive controllability. Okay.
Thank you.
So there is some different kind of controllability. So first, the exact controllability means if we get our target exactly, then it is called the exact controllability. And approximate controllability means we not achieve the target, but we reach in the neighborhood of the our target, then that is called the approximate controllability. So you can see that exact controllability means steering the state vector of a control system from an arbitrary initial state vector to an arbitrary final state vector by using the set of admissible control. So this suitable control, the set of all suitable controls which control the our system and which help to get the our target, that is called the admissible controls. Okay. So exact controllability means we get exactly our target, then it is called the exact controllable. And then we have the approximate controllability means we not achieve the our exact target, but we are in the epsilon neighborhood of our target. So that is called approximate controllability. And example, you can think that exact controllability, for example, nowadays, you can see that they are the bombardment and satellite and many things, okay? So if we want to send our satellite in some fixed orbit, so that is called the, can be considered as the controllability problem. And approximate controllability means, for example, if we want to target some point by the missile, we not reach at the exact target, but we went in the neighborhood of the target, then that is the considered as the approximate controllability. And then here is also a concept called the null controllability. Null controllability means we reach to this origin from the state, from the initial point to the origin, that is called the null controllability. And then we have the total controllability. We also need to remember that this achieving the target, for the achieving the target, we have only finite time interval. We cannot use the infinite time, because if we will achieve anything in the infinite time, then that will be not useful. So we need in the finite time interval, and in that finite time interval, we want to achieve our target. So total controllability means, for example, our differential equation is defined on some interval 0 to t. Then what we did, we just divide our this interval 0 to t in the sum interval, sub intervals, and our system is controllable in each sub interval. Then this kind of controllability is called the total controllability. Okay. So another concept here, I am going to use the impulses. Okay, so there are the generally two kind of impulses. So what is the impulses? Impulsive condition. Impulsive condition means if there is some sudden change in their state, then that system is called the impulsive system. For example, if we just put for example, this earthquake and all these things, they are the, can be considered as the impulsive condition, because they occurs for a very, very short time period, but they are this time period is negligible to the our whole time. Okay, so this is, and they are very strong also. And just we have put the hammer on some steel for a with the strong force, then that is also can be considered as the some impulsive condition. So there are the two kind of impulsive condition. One is called the instantaneous condition and another is called the non-instantaneous condition. So instantaneous means we have this impact of this impulses are for a very short time interval. For example, the hammer, we target some steel by the hammer. So for the, just for the fraction of second, we put the lot of force on the steel, and earthquake and all these things. This natural disaster, they can be considered as the instantaneous impulsive system, okay? So another is the non-instantaneous impulsive system. Here we have this system is, if the duration of these changes continuous over a finite time interval, means that is not very short, that can be occur for a finite time interval, then that kind of impulsive condition is the non-instantaneous impulsive condition. And this condition is, for example, if anyone have the sugar problem, so when doctor did the introduction of the insulin in the bloodstream, then this absorption of this insulin in the blood is an abrupt change, and consequent absorption that is a gradual process and it remains active for a finite time interval. So this will take some time. When we put some insulin in the sugar in the body, then mixing of this insulin with the blood, that takes some time. And so that's why this process we can consider as the non-instantaneous impulsive process. So here we have another thing that is called the switching system. For example, here we have this same system, and then in the same system for a some time interval, one mode is active, and in the some other time interval, another mode is active, and another time interval, another mode is active. Maybe the in the different time interval, same mode will act, okay? But for the different time interval, that will be the all the it also possible that at the same time all the mode are working, okay? So this kind of thing is called the switching system. And example is our in the daily life, for example, we have the fan and many electric switches, okay? So maybe we have three switches at the time, then we maybe on one switch and we have deactivated two switch, they are not on. So this can be considered as the switch system. So how we are going to apply this switching system on this time scale theory? So this thing here, we can see that if we have some differential equation dx over dt. So if t is less than equal to t1, then our mode is f1 will work. And if t lie between t1 and t2, then f2 dx over dt is equal to f2x, this mode work. And again, in this interval t2 and t3, we again have the f1 mode. And if we have the t greater than t3, then f3 is work. So this one, what is the mode here? 1, 2, 1 and 3. So here 1, 2, 1, 3 is called the switching mode sequence. So here is the, I think, if anyone want to ask some question related with this three concept, then you can ask, and then we can start this some research problem. This will be very lengthy and all kind of things, okay? So if anyone want to ask anything about this thing, then you can ask. So if anyone want to find some references for this time scale theory, then he can see the book of one professor, Martin Bonner from the US. He the written two book on the time scale, and that is the very fundamental and very good book. So and this work is the published by me and my student Bipin Kumar. So this is the we are going to discuss about the controllability of a neutral differential equation on time scale. So neutral means we have the also some differential equation with delay. So any differential equation which contains the derivative with and without delay, that is called the neutral differential equation. So here we have just assumed this finite dimensional system and this matrix A depending on t, and here our derivative is with without delay and with delay. That's why this is called the neutral differential equation. And this differential equation is not the simple initial value problem. This is the impulsive differential equation. We can see that this xtk plus 1 minus xtk minus. What is this xtk plus 1? This is the value of x at tk from right. And then this xtk minus 1 is the value of x, the left limit of x at tk from left. Okay. So, and this is ik, this some suitable function. So, this is our impulsive condition. In the middle equation, this is the our impulsive condition, and this is the instantaneous. This is the instantaneous impulsive condition. Why? Because this we have the this xtk plus minus xtk minus. So, we coming to the from the left and right. And both the value are not same. They are just fraction of second. They are the differences. Okay, that's why it is the instantaneous impulsive condition. So in this case, we try to find this how this system we going to control. Find the controllability of this system. And also, I want to tell one thing that the controllability concept. For the two systems, one is the finite dimensional system and another is the infinite dimensional system. So for the finite dimensional system means if we work on the matrix system, so there the controllability means exact controllability, approximate controllability, null controllability, all these concepts coincide with each other. Means controllability imply the approximate controllability, and approximate controllability imply the controllability and even null controllability. But in the case of the infinite dimensional system, means if we consider our differential equation in some general Banach space, Hilbert space, or in the set of all continuous function, or in the L2 space, then there this concept of exact controllability, approximate controllability, null controllability, they will be different. And so here we have considered the finite dimensional system because it is the matrix, okay, n by n matrix, and this it is the CRD. CRD means RD continuous coefficient, this element of the matrix A are the RD continuous function, and this is going to the MNR. Similarly, BT is also this CRD continuous function, and they are in a n cross m matrix. So because these are the impulsive system, so we cannot solve this system on the set of all continuous set and so on. So what we did, we need the piecewise continuous space. We need the piecewise continuous space, and we will defined on this piecewise continuous space one supremum norm, and then we can see that with this supremum norm, this piecewise continuous set of piecewise continuous function is the Banach space. So now here we want to apply the fixed point method for solving the this system. So here we have this finite dimensional system, and then the solution of this system is given by this equation number 6, what we have done already. So if we have any system 5, then this Gramianian matrix or controllability Gramianian matrix WTT is invertible, and then our system 5 will be controllable. For this, if anyone want to find this reference for this work, then please you can see this the work of the Professor Davis and this Jackson. They are the professor in some US university. So this is the very good work, and this is the fundamental work for this controllability of the finite dimensional system on time scale. So we have used this this result to solve our system. So with the help of this above problem, we are able to define that the solution of our impulsive system can be found in this way. And for finding the to use the fixed point method for solving this our control system, we need some condition. First, we need what? The control will our linear system must be controllable, and then we need this Lipschitz condition in the second variable, and then we also need that this our function f is the bounded and satisfied the growth type condition, and then function g is also satisfy the this Lipschitz condition in the second variable, and this satisfied this growth condition, and this impulsive function this also satisfy the Lipschitz condition, and they also bounded by mi. So with the help, we need to define this control u in such a way that ut is the control, and then the control function ut is the state xt of our problem from x0 to xt. Also the estimate of the control function ut is mu, where this is the our z function zx. So I think here it will be very difficult to explain each and everything in detail that how we form this ut. So for the construction of this ut, either you can see my the research paper, or you can see the research work of the Professor Raju K. George. That will be very much fundamental of the work of the Professor Raju George. And then also you can see that Professor M.J. Davis' work on this controllability. So with this suitable control u, where z is this, is we can see that our system is achieve our target from x0 to xt. This x0 is the initial point, and this xt we denote by the our target. So with this assumptions, and we with this one very nice condition, this less than one, we can use the fixed point Banach fixed point theorem, and then we can prove that our system is controllable. And then we have the, we can extend our result for the integral differential system. So here is the example. We have used the MATLAB in order to find this numerical solution of our problem. So here we choose the some particular matrix. First we solve this system on the set of real number, and then after that we solve for the we have taken here different time scale, t is equal to r and t is equal to p11, and then we will see that this satisfies this our condition. Okay, so non-instantaneous system also we have, and then here again we choose the our why here it is called the non-instantaneous system. This here xt is equal to gk, this is the our impulsive condition, and this is the impulsive interval on which we have the some special condition on the our state variable x, and this y is the our output function. So how are we going to solve this problem? So this paper is published in this I think ASEAN Journal of Control with the with my research scholar Dr. Vipin Kumar. Now he is working as a postdoctoral fellow at Max Planck Institute in Germany. Okay, so if anyone wants some work on this time scale and controllability, then I will be able to provide him. Even I can provide the soft copy of this book of the Martin. Okay, so this is the impulsive condition. Then again we need this one space of piecewise continuous function with this supremum norm PC norm, and then we can see that this is the Banach space, and again we can apply this fixed point theorem to find this so the controllability of this problem. Then again we have to define the solution of our problem. So most important part for this our system is to find this solution of the our system, and then find this matrices. These matrices are this matrices W0, WK, and this thing. And once we are able to find this Gramignan matrices, then we are able to prove that our system will be controllable. So with the help of these matrices, we can define the control. And then we need some condition, and these are the this our system will be controllable if this is this matrix has the rank n. So this rank n, this rank n condition, that is very much similar to the Kalman condition for the finite dimensional system, okay, for the controllability of the finite dimensional system. So here again we have proof for the observability, but that is the I think not possible to solve it. So here again we have given some example, and then we use the MATLAB to find this that how our this xt is equal to 3. So we can see that this satisfied this at 3 is equal to this, t is equal to 3, this our satisfied xt is equal to 3 satisfying this our controllability condition. So we have choose the different time scale, and then with the help of this MATLAB, and we try to find the that this is satisfied. So even in the switch system also, we can use this time scale theory to prove the controllability of the switch system. Here we have chosen the switch system, and this RT is the switch law. This RT is the our switch law here. So if RT is changed, then our this dynamics of our model also change. So here we can define this solution of our problem on this PC continuous space, and then with the help of that, why we need this thing, because this is also our impulsive problem, so we need the piecewise continuous space with the some supremum norm, and then we define this matrices, and we try to find the this result that this is controllable. Okay, so this thing again we use this total controllability for this Kalman type condition to prove that this our system is controllable. So here is the our example. So if anyone want to ask any problem, any question, then these are the some important references for this time scale theory and controllability of on time scale. So this is my one paper very recently published in 2020 in nonlinear analysis hybrid system with my PhD student and my one collaborator from France, and this DGMI. Okay, so this is the very abstract result. This is in the infinite dimensional system, and then this is the general of Franklin. So these are the if anyone want, then I can provide this references for this work. Okay, so this book, this Martin Bonner book is very fundamental, and this Hilger, he was the first person who introduced the time scale in his PhD thesis in 1988. Okay, and this Davis S, he had this some very good research on the MATLAB on the time scale. So if anyone want to find this work on the time scale and controllability, and then he can see this his web page, Davis web page, and the book of the this Martin. So if anyone want to study this impulsive system, non instantaneous impulsive system, then this Regan paper in the Proceeding of American Mathematical Society, this is the first paper which is work published in the case of in this non-instantaneous impulsive cases. So thank you very much for your attention. So if anyone have any question, then please you can ask.
Thank you very much, Professor Malik. ¿Alguien tiene pregunta, duda, comentario, algo? Tenemos 3 minutos.
I have a question.
Yeah, please.
Yeah. So the controllability result you said.
Ah, hello, sir. Kind of,
how are you?
I am good. How are you?
Yeah, fine. Thanks.
Good. Yeah. Yes.
The controllability result you were mentioning in this talk. So yes. What kind of controllability? Finally, I didn't understand. Is the most strong, or meaning you have different types of controllability, right?
Yeah, like we have
total
because
or
yeah, total controllability and then approximate controllability and exact controllability. Actually,
yeah.
in this work, we have used this finite dimensional system. Okay, so my all the presentation was on the finite dimensional system, and on the finite dimensional system, this concept of controllability, exact controllability, approximate controllability, and null controllability, they are same. Okay, so generally we use the controllability, but also we use this total controllability. Total controllability and controllability, these are the some different concept. Total controllability means if we have our total interval is 0 to t, so we subdivide our interval in the sub interval, and then we check the controllability on each sub interval.
Which means that on each, mean you want to know whether you can put the control on some sub interval and whether you can control the whole thing, or you have to put controls on
that
each
is
sub
also.
Interval.
Yeah, it is also, we define the controls on each sub-interval.
It has to be on each, or it can be on only some of the sub-interval?
No, we can do also. Total controllability means it should be controllable on each sub-interval. Okay.
I mean, where do you put the control? On each sub-interval?
We put on each sub-interval. For each sub-interval, we define the control, different control. And then we use that, it satisfied not only at the first initial point and the final end point, it also satisfied at the first point and the end point of each sub interval.
Thank you.
Thank you.
¿Alguien más tiene pregunta, duda, comentario, algo? Si no, paramos acá. Okay, Professor Malik. So we stop here. Thank you very much again for the talk.
Okay, thank you very much.
Muslim, very nice talk. Very.
Professor Rabi.
You try to keep it very elementary for many of the students, I think. So it was very nice. Thanks.
Yeah, it was the very fundamental work related with the time scale theory. So it may be, maybe some people may be interested in this theory, and it is also very new. So there are a lot of scope for the research and many things on this topic.
No, but recently many things came for the fractional time also.
Fractional is a little more older than this.
No, I'm saying in the time scale sense.
Time scale, actually, I once meet with this Professor Martin Bonner. And he is the, you can think that he is the founder of this time scale theory. So he has some doubts about this time scale theory for the fractional derivative also. And I also have little some doubt, but many people also use it. Time fractional derivative on time scale, because we not sure that how it is defined this time scale on this fraction. So that is the only issue with that. But in the some cases it is also well defined, but it is not very general. That's why I not prefer to discuss the fractional derivative on time scale.
Yeah, and that's also some maybe you have seen the time with the random function.
Random function. I don't know, but that may be that age structure type system maybe. I think this Professor Juwa, he is working on something similar to that.
He went ahead, actually.
Yeah. He is nowadays he is working on this deep learning and differential equation, optimal control. My PhD student who is working in Max Planck. Now he is also trying to work on this deep learning and optimal control problem, and he also discussed with Professor Juwa. also.
Yeah,
so
the whole group of France and this Germany, they are also, they are tending towards this machine learning and things like that.
Yes, yes, you are right. So he is also working nowadays on that thing.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much. We have
okay,
to close
thank you very much for your invitation. And I am happy that I meet with Professor Madhavan. Okay.
No, I'm just Rajesh, you know me.
Rajesh, yes.
it's always a pleasure to meet great people like Rajesh.
Yeah, Ravi, you can maybe stop this recording, okay?
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay then.